Thank you. Okay, so we are Les Malheureux, which means in French, the unfortunate ones, which is probably you. So what we do is basically we both write flash fiction, or short stories as we like to call them. And we got bored of just reading them, so David decided to set them to music and create some visuals, which hopefully you'll be able to see. So it's basically me reading out our stuff with music, so it's not, I'm not singing, so don't worry. Geography, and I thought that was the bomb. All the other fellas on the site just seemed to like Led Zepp and slasher films, and uploading wacky photos of themselves giving thumbs up next to extreme sport posters. So I arranged to go on a day reeve with Jeff, and we met beside the museum's mirror ball to set our parameters, sticking to the shade and stopping at every junction to listen to the voices beneath the pavement. We looked up to the tops of buildings, and we looked down on the ground, and we looked sideways at each other, and we discovered all kinds of things about our place in the city. If it wasn't for the matching Ramones t-shirts from Urban Outfitters, we could have really gone somewhere. But that's like girls ending up with the same M&S coat as their mothers. The algorithm's all wrong. Thanks.
Thank you.
Now I have to warn you, there is a swear word in this, so please don't be offended. It's the only one. The history brush. When you live here in Edinburgh, Mr. Fuller said, you don't even see the towers. It's as if the towers aren't there. They are not there to all intents and purposes. I mean, they are there, but they're not. Not really. I accept that when an outsider sees a house in Edinburgh, they notice the big fuck-off power plant with 8 huge cooling towers in the background. But that's not what Edinburgh people see. They see the sky. Of how the houses in Edinburgh would look if you actually lived here. I showed Mr. Fuller how you could use the history brush to wipe over the towers and replace them with blue sky. Excellent, Mr. Fuller said. How about I add something, I said. What were you thinking of? I was thinking of a rainbow. Mr. Fuller went to the window and looked out. I've seen rainbows in Edinburgh. It's possible. It wouldn't be a lie. But doesn't that mean it's been raining? Look, and I showed him what I'd done, liquid ribbons of colour shimmering. I enjoyed replacing the towers with rainbows, but after a few weeks got bored and began to add tiny unicorns as well, hidden in the dappled shadows of lawns. You could hardly see them, but I knew they were there. And every time I sneaked a unicorn into one of the photos, that house sold quicker than any of the others. I didn't tell Mr. Fuller. He was a practical man who liked to believe his achievements were down to human ingenuity. Magic had no place in the story of Mr. Fuller's success. Everything's west of something. Here, catch, I said, and time slowed down as the vase arced through the air. You can discover everything about your girlfriend by tossing a breakable object towards her. Is she poised, confident in her judgments? Does she seem willing to take responsibility for someone else's actions? Is she comfortable with spontaneity? What is her attitude to risk, debt, transgression, sin, guilt? How does she experience the passing of time? Does she appear to believe in an afterlife, an interventionist god, ghosts, fate, predestination? Does she demonstrate a belief that character is learned? Is she concerned with the existential? You learn most if the object belongs to someone else. Watch the vase, watch the girl, and you will know all these things. And you will find out if she loves you. We looked at the porcelain shards, then out through the rain-speckled window. The gate said, West Woods. She was the first girl I dated whose house had no number. Thank you very much. Little Jam. I was the only Janet in the office before she arrived, but there was no problem until one day I asked Harriet for the long stapler and she said she'd given it to Little Jan. Little Jan? She wasn't particularly little and I'm not especially big. I didn't want to be known as Big Jan like some bulldike prisoner. Harriet tried to reassure me. The new Janet was Little Jan, but I would always be Jan. But they might as well write fat cow on my forehead for all the difference that I made. So-called Little Jan is a 12 at least and not Topshop, more like Marks. So while recovering the long stapler, I told Jan all about fast track promotion in this place, the people to influence and how to do it. Now I'm still Jan, but she's known as Stockroom Jan, and she's off long term with stress. Thanks. Okay, this is the last one in this bit. Do birds die flying? Christopher's shared terrace smelled of scorched pelt. Wednesday evening saw him at his local church hall studying taxidermy. His thing was stuffing mice. He enjoyed manipulating the creatures into sardonic poses, twiddling a cigarette holder, say, or reclining on a miniature chaise longue sourced from a specialist doll's house website. He kept the mice in the freezer. His housemates weren't keen, but eventually conceded that he had saved the rodents from boa constrictors slithering around tanks in some lemon tube front room. Christopher's day job for the past 6 months had been painting balconies and something called skirts at an Art Deco apartment block. The cherry picker sirens annoyed the residents at first, but when Christopher was in the air, he achieved a zen-like state and his brushstrokes were immaculate. The degree in fine art had not gone to waste. He stopped buying mice. Him collecting the dead pigeons benefited everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back. So, I See Electric. The first time it happens is a Wednesday before work. I'm about to straighten my hair when a neon thread crackles into life and reaches for the plug's pins, catching me by surprise. Surprises are good. I start leaving switches on, sweeping my toes close by sockets and feeling the surge of energy pull at my core. Everywhere I look, I see networks of bright blue veins and the walls pulsing with life. Every time I flick on the kettle or dim the lights, my temperature rises a notch and my breathing picks up its pace. It tingles and teases, tempting me to stick my fingers in fixtures and fuse boxes. We need to connect. Craving for bigger, better buzzes controls my mind and my body. I take to standing beneath pylons for stimulation. The air is supercharged and fizzing. Ions zap my skin and the mammoth structures hum with potential. I want the ultimate high, so I start climbing. I get up quickly and gaze at the ruby red beacons of the city's towers. The power lines purr in my ear tantalizingly, and I reach up, thrilled and throbbing. Thank you. Ooh, that's a bit saucy for this time of the afternoon, isn't it? Okay. Leonard. Leonard was famous for his skilled curation of Mossorama, a touring exhibition of moss from Darwin's collection. He was so obsessed with Mossorama, he would pose as a visitor and ask invigilators how it was doing. They would laugh and say, well, to be honest, we had high hopes, but it seems nobody is excited by moss anymore. Leonard is 60 now, fat, diabetic, and addicted to flu-strength paracetamol. He has no job, owns no property, and is well out of the moss world. Categorising moss, he says, is a young man's game. Why doesn't he have a woman? He is funny, has teeth, hair, and a motorbike, and is an expert on 1930s science fiction and moss. But who ever met a girl in the sci-fi section of a bookshop or at a moss exhibition? Sometimes you have to accept that no one will ever love you. This is set in the corner house, so it's going to start becoming a bit of a down memory lane thing soon. Everyone has a favourite spot. Sylvia likes to sit on the front row at the cinema. I discover this on our second date when she marches straight down the unsettling slope. It's not somewhere I'd pick, but I'm not consulted. I'd never even sat on the front row until I met Sylvia. I like to position myself halfway along a row, halfway from the back, safe middle ground. Near enough the exit in the event of a fire or a sudden urge to pee, far enough from the projector to not hear it click and whir. Sylvia likes the front row shape, she says, because it makes her feel part of the action. All I feel are my ears bleeding and the progressive nagging of my neck. And I can't concentrate on the film once I've noticed the little holes in the screen where the light is sucked through. Sylvia has made me sit to her left because she's decided I'm right-handed. She decided this on our first date in a summer evening beer garden where she watched how I pick up my drink and light my cigarettes. She decided correctly. Sylvia tells me a right-handed man should always sit on the left-hand side of a woman in the cinema so he can grope her effectively when the lights go down. I assume this means she's given me the nod to put my hand between her legs. I assume wrong. Sylvia hisses, "You can only do that on the back row." And she doesn't sit on the back row, ever. So much for feeling part of the action. We wait for the credits to roll and leave in silence. There is no third date. Okay, this is our last one, so thanks for having us. Potato Smiles. When Debbie left, I ate nothing but potato smiles with no frills ketchup. One day I looked at the fluffy orange discs grinning up at me and decided to save one. I stuck it to the wall next to my bed and it cheered me up. The next day I saved another, but I'd had one of my funny days, so I stuck this one upside down to make a frown. I did this for months, and the pattern reminded me how well I was doing. The man from Environmental Services had a big oblong body built for blocking doorways. "The neighbours are talking about a smell," he said. I locked the door and made him sit, while I removed the smiles and heaped them on a plate in front of him. The sauce bottle was rimmed with decaying ketchup scabs. I squeezed hard until his plate was full. Thank you.